Welcome to our latest Wondering Walks of Wonder Walking Tour. Today we're headed to the beautiful southern town of Beaufort, South Carolina. Beaufort has a long history that dates back to more than 400 years ago when the Spanish Empire first sailed into Port Royal's harbor. By 1700, four national flags had flown over the area: the Spanish, the French, the Scots, and the English. In 1710, the Lord's proprietor decided to establish a fort upon the river called Port Royal for ships of Great Britain to take in masts, pitch, tar, turpentine, and other naval stores. Accordingly, Beaufort was laid out in December of 1710 and named in honor of one of the proprietors, Henry the Duke of Beaufort. In 1715, as the settlers pushed the Indians further inland, the Yamasee War erupted. Rampaging Yamasee Indians ravaged the area of Beaufort, ransacking and burning homes and slaughtering the cattle in the fields. Survivors took refuge on a ship anchored in the harbor, and it would not be until 1719 that the King of England was again fully in charge of the province. The years of royal government would be stable and prosperous ones, with the export of rice and indigo to England bringing great profit. As their prosperity increased, the area planters built beautiful homes here in Beaufort, several of which we will see on today's walk. The town, though, was occupied by the British during the American Revolution and was quickly occupied by Union forces during the War between the States in 1861. Many of the homes were used for offices, quarters, and hospitals, and because of this, several of these homes that we see that date back into the late and early 1860s are still been saved from destruction. Beaufort prospered during the Reconstruction era after the Civil War, when rice and cotton were planted and exported. As we go through the neighborhoods and downtown area of Beaufort, we'll see that much of the current landscape that we see today was influenced by cataclysmic events that bookend the arrival of the 20th century. A great hurricane scored a direct hit on the town in 1893, and in 1907, a devastating fire swept through the downtown streets. Fishing and truck farming carried the local economy until two military bases were constructed in the area as a buildup to World War II. To this day, the military remains the number one economic backbone of this collection of islands here in South Carolina. The original settlement in Beaufort can still be found in the downtown area historic area, which has about 304 acres that are designated as a National Historic Landmark. We're now going to be walking along Bay Street, where we'll see some of the more historic as well as beautifully preserved homes. The first home that we see is the William Elliott House, also known as the Anchorage. The original three-story tabby house probably dates back to about 1800, although local tradition has long held that William Elliott built this house prior to the Revolution. The Elliott family owned Paris Island prior to secession, and an event that was strongly opposed by William Elliott III, a well-known author, politician, as well as sportsman. He was strongly pro-Southern and in favor of slavery, and was one of the most respected voices of restraint in the state. He remained a staunch Unionist until the war broke out, when he went along with his state. During the occupation of Beaufort, the house was used as a hospital and designated as the Mission House. It was greatly altered in the early 1900s by a retired naval officer, Admiral Beardsley, who spent $80,000 at the time remodeling it, adding stucco to the interior and a much more ornately carved woodwork throughout the interior of the house. This next home is the Thomas More Rhett House. Thomas Smith was the oldest of 17 children. In the early 1800s, as an uncle with the last name of Rhett, near death without anyone to carry on his name, he promised to bequeath his fortune to nephews who would carry on the Rhett name. Six obliged, taking the family name of their great-great-grandfather, Wilhelm Rhett, an early Charleston military and pirate fighter. With his inheritance, Thomas Rhett was also able to create this notable Adamesque house with two-story wraparound piazzas and transom-lighted doorways. The Rhett House today has been adapted for use as a bed and breakfast. This next home was built by William Fickling. Fickling, a teacher, built the original house here probably sometime in the 1790s. After his death in 1807, his wife sold the property, and over the years it evolved into a two-story clapboard-style house that once served as the rectory of St. Helena Episcopal Church. This is the Milton Maxey House, also known as the Succession House. Milton Maxey came to town from Massachusetts in 1804 to found a school for young men with his brother Virgil. He acquired this property with a tabby two-story house reportedly dated to 1743, and around 1813 removed the tabby second floor and added two stories of wood siding. In the 1850s, Edmund Rhett, lawyer, planter, and outspoken champion of states' rights as a representative and senator, bought the house and extensively remodeled it into the Greek Revival style that we see today. The house was long known as the Succession House as the scene of many informal discussions and formal meetings during the 1850s by Rhett and his allies advocating secession and Southern independence. House here at the corner is the John A. Cuthbert House. Two clashing stories have traveled the decades to explain the existence of this really ornate house. One suggests that it was built near Wires Pond, but after much sickness and several deaths, the family blamed the fetid waters and had the house sawed in half and moved to its present site. Another legend states that the house was built as a Presbyterian mansion and was acquired and moved by the Cuthbert family. Apparently, there is evidence to support both claims, but neither can be definitively verified. For the house, whose front portion dates to 1810, and it underwent significant remodeling in the 1830s and 1840s. Robert Means, a prominent Beaufort merchant and planter, either built this house around 1800 or purchased it from a gentleman named John Bull. The house remained in the Means family until it was sold at a direct tax sale in the 1860s. George Gage, an Ohio native and later chief engineer of the Port Royal Railroad, purchased the house in 1872, and the house remained in Gage's family until 1919, when it was sold to Major Edward Denby of Michigan. Denby was the Secretary of the Navy under President William G. Harding and was among the cabinet members accused in the Teapot Dome scandal of 1923. This beautiful home we see here is the Thomas Fuller House. The Fuller House was completed in 1786 and is one of Beaufort's outstanding examples of a large resident built a tabby, the local building material composed of oyster shells and lime mortar. Thomas Fuller was a prosperous local planner who created 80 perfectly proportioned rooms, or eight perfectly proportioned rooms, including three completely paneled in heart pine and cypress. He built this house as a wedding present for his bride, Elizabeth Middleton. It's a historical fact that Francis Griswold wrote his renowned Civil War novel, A Sea Island Lady, while staying in the house. Our next house is the Charles Edward Leverett House. Legend has it that this plantation house was built on St. Helena Island in the early 1800s and floated here by boat around 1850. Although that tale cannot be truly documented, it is known that Charles Edward Leverett, the last rector of Old Sheldon Church, purchased the property in 1854 for about $1,800. Luckier than most of his neighbors, Leverett, after an impassioned plea, regained ownership of his home after the war, after the Civil War, and it remained in the family until the 1920s. General Stephen Bull, leery of the strong winds blowing off the bay, constructed a one-story cottage on this lot around 1910. The current house that we see was built in the early 1930s on the foundation of that original cottage. The house is surrounded with a cast iron fence reportedly made from Swedish ore. William Ritchie was a Union Army infantryman from Connecticut who decided to remain in South Carolina after the Civil War and built one of the first early Victorian homes here in 1883. As we continue to walk along Bay Street, we now take a look at the John Joyner Smith House. When John Joyner Smith, a Beaufort plantation owner, built his Federal-style house in 1813, the entrance was on Bay Street. A Greek Revival-era remodeling located the entrance to its present location along Wilmington Street and resulted in modifications to the interior. During the Civil War, the house was occupied by Brigadier General Isaac Ingalls Stevens, commander of Union forces along the coast of South Carolina. Stevens was the first governor of the Washington Territory, as well as a United States congressman. While charging with his troops at the Battle of Chantilly in 1862, Stevens was struck in the head by a bullet and instantly killed. Hazard Stevens, Isaac's son, was also injured in the Battle of Chantilly. He also became a general in the U.S. Army and an author, and along with P.B. Van Trump, was the first to climb Mount Rainier. Originally built in 1785 by Edward Barnwell, Union officers quartered in this house during the Civil War. It also served as a signal station and U.S. telegraph office. The next home we see on our stop was once owned by E.A. Shepherd. When E.A. Shepherd built this house in the 1890s, it had elaborate gingerbread exterior trim that was very typical of the Victorian fashion in its day. In 1938, the house was bought and almost totally rebuilt, transforming the interior and exterior style from Victorian to neo-colonial. There aren't many Art Deco homes in Beaufort, or buildings in Beaufort, but the one that we see here today is one of the most beautiful, and that is the Beaufort Federal Courthouse. Robert McGrath of Augusta, Georgia, was the architect of the original brick courthouse that stood on this location in 1883. During the Depression in the 1930s, it received this Art Deco makeover. Emil E. Lingnick would recognize this Queen Anne-style home today, a century after he built it around 1907. The turret with its steeply pitched roof shows the Gothic influence on the eclectic Victorian period architecture. We're now entering the grounds of St. Helena's Episcopal Church. The parish of St. Helena was established in 1712 and construction on the church began in 1724. That first structure was rebuilt in 1769 with an extension added to the west that was completed in 1817. In 1824, the entire church, save for that last extension, was demolished to ground level and new sidewalls were extended to the church to the north and to the south. During the Civil War, the church was used as a hospital, and the tombstones of the graveyard were pressed into emergency service as operating tables. The present altar was donated by the sailors of the USS New Hampshire, which was stationed here after the Civil War. The upper stages of the tower were added in 1942 and were designed by Albert Simmons of Charleston, South Carolina. One of the first persons to be buried in the churchyard was Colonel John Barnwell, better known as Tuscarora Jack. He died in 1724. His grave, along with others, lies beneath the church. Two British officers killed in a skirmish near Port Royal during the Revolution were buried by Captain John Barnwell on the right side of the brick wall on the west side of the church. Also buried here are two Confederate generals, Lieutenant General Richard E. Anderson and Brigadier General Stephen Elliott. Anderson was a West Pointer who resigned to serve the Confederacy and who was reduced to toiling as a day laborer after the war. The Baptist Church of Beaufort is a great example of a Greek Revival type architecture here in town. It was built in 1844 at a cost then of about $10,000. The steeple dates to about 1961. The interior sports some of the finest plaster decorative work in Beaufort. The congregation dates to 1804 and grew rapidly under the dynamic direction of Richard Fuller, a Harvard-educated lawyer who converted to the Baptist faith after a joint religious revival held by the Presbyterians, Episcopal, and Baptist churches in 1831. By 1857, the membership consisted of 182 white members and 3,317 enslaved people. During the Civil War, the church was used as Union Army Hospital number 14. Our next historic church here is the Tabernacle Baptist Church. A hurricane in 1893 damaged enough of the original 1840 building to have it rebuilt and rededicated. In the graveyard is a memorial to Robert Smalls, born into slavery in Beaufort in 1839. Smalls, self-taught and wise to the tricky currents and channels of the Charleston Harbor as a pilot aboard the steamer Planner, engineered his freedom during the Civil War with a daring escape past Confederate ships in the Purloined Ship. With a crew of 12 fellow slaves, he delivered the Planter to the commanding officer of the Union fleet. Later, President Abraham Lincoln received Smalls in Washington, D.C. and rewarded him and his crew for their valor. He was given official command of the Planter and made a captain in the U.S. Navy. In this position, he served throughout the Civil War. With his $1,500 reward money, Smalls bought the estate of his former master on Prince Street and opened a local store. He entered public service and served terms in the South Carolina House of Representatives and Senate, as well as five terms in the U.S. House of Representatives. Smalls also served as a major general in the state militia and later served as port collector for Beaufort. construction of this house that we see is attributed to W.G. Jenkins and built about 1845. Although the present two-story portico is thought to have been replaced as a veranda, this house is still a great example of a well-designed, finely proportioned Beaufort house. We're now walking past the Beaufort Arsenal, which now serves as the historical museum for Beaufort. The Beaufort Volunteer Artillery was organized in April of 1775 and is the fifth oldest military unit in the United States. Construction of the Beaufort Arsenal began in 1795 and was completed by 1799. Severely deteriorated by 1852, the arsenal was rebuilt, and the building was enlarged and renovated in 1934 as part of a WPA, or Works Progress Administration, program during the Great Depression. The museum itself now houses over 6,000 artifacts and occupies the entire site. We're now walking along about the 500 block of Craven Street. This block features houses, some nearly mirror images of themselves, that was built in and many of these were built in the 1880s and 1890s. All have decorations made by woodworking machinery, which was newly invented in the late 19th century. Several have turrets and towers, some have colored glass, most have decorative spindles that was popular with the designs in the late 1890s for homes. Many have bay windows, and several have nice porches. Our next house is the Joseph Johnson House, or also known as the Castle. This house is considered to be one of the great houses of the South Carolina coast. The house sits amid giant live oaks on a full city block. With its lush gardens of azaleas and camellias, it is one of the most photographed houses in the United States. The castle was completed in 1861, although some elements of the house, including decorative ironwork and porch railings, were snared in the Union naval blockade at the start of the Civil War. The exterior color is muted and changeable, sometimes it's shades of gray, tan, even pink. And those colors vary and shift with the light of the day. Six massive columns support the double portico with balusters between the enclosed upper and lower porches. Dr. Johnson, unlike many of Beaufort's pre-war residents, was able to reacquire the house after it was confiscated during the Civil War. He had to pay $2,000 in taxes to get his house back, and the house remained in Johnson's family until 1981. The Henry Farmer House dates back to 1810. This house was the home of Baptist leader Richard Fuller. His wife owned Cat Island. The house that we see here on our right is called Moreland's. The original house on this property was destroyed by a fire in the 1890s, and the present house that we see today was constructed on top of that tabby foundation that dates to those late 1700s when the original house was built. We saw a couple other houses earlier in our walk owned by the Rhett brothers. This is another one owned by James Rhett. Rhett designed this house in the 1880s for his new bride in mind, with spacious verandas and doors to maximize cross ventilation for those warm summer evenings that we have here in South Carolina. Another beautiful home that sits here right on the harbor or on the bay is Marshlands, which was built in 1814 for Dr. James Robert Verter, who achieved prominence when he discovered a treatment for yellow fever. During the Civil War, this house was used as headquarters for the United States Sanitary Commission. Set high from the ground upon a tabby arcade, the two-story house gives evidence of West Indian influence in the single-story veranda that runs the length of the front and on the sides of the house. The sheet metal roof is painted red and the shutters are dark green. The Paul Hamilton House, as we can see with the live oak in front of us, is also known as the Oaks. Paul Hamilton was the grandson of President James Madison's Secretary of the Navy. He completed this Italianate-style structure with wide porches in 1855. The family deserted the house during the Civil War, and Union troops established Hospital No. 1 here. With the help of friends, Hamilton was able to regain possession of this oak-kissed property after the Civil War. Movie fans may recognize the Edward Fripp House. According to Fripp family legend, when James Fripp returned after the Civil War, he arrived just as the large 1853 Italianate frame house was being sold for taxes by the U.S. Tax Commission. Unable to bid on the house, he stood in front of it with tears coursing down his cheeks. A Frenchman who had been living in the area and who was very sympathetic to the South purchased the home. He is said to have walked over to the former owner, presented him with the deed, kissed him upon both cheeks, and turned around and left, returning to France. Mr. Fripp never had a chance to repay him back. The house was extensively altered after the hurricane of 1893 blew off the roof, and it served as a guest house from the 1930s until 1974. After being restored as a private residence, it became famous to film fans as the house of Kevin Kline and Glenn Close, who hosted a group of college friends reuniting for a funeral in the movie The Big Chill. The early morning jogging scene in the movie, complete with banter on inside trading, was filmed along historic Bay Street that we saw many of the beautiful homes earlier on this walk. But it wasn't the first time that this home appeared on a silver screen. In the 1979 Robert Duvall movie, The Great Santini, it served as Duvall's home. Our next house that we see is the Elizabeth Hext House. Now, this house dates back to 1720 and is set high on its tabby foundation, and it's considered to be one of Beaufort's oldest houses. The original house consisted of upper and lower piazzas with a narrow central hall flanked by two rooms on the main floor. Elizabeth Hext, the only child of Francis Hext Jr. and Elizabeth Stanyarn, was born in 1746. At the age of 15, she married William Sam of Wattamolo Island, who was the grandson of Tuscarora Jack Barnwell. In 1783, he bought Dalpha Island near Beaufort, and here they lived and raised a large family. When Elizabeth Sam died in 1813, she was buried beside her husband on Dalpha Island. The Hext House remained in the Sam family until 1864, when it was sold for $640 by the U.S. Tax Commission. This house is known as the Little Taj. It actually takes its name from the reflection on a tidal basin that was much larger that stood in front of this house at one time. The house is a typical small Beaufort-style home with porches at the front on both floors and wings to bring the breezes into rear rooms of the house. It dates back to the 1850s, although there's some evidence that it may have been standing in the early 1820s. The first African Baptist church was originally a prayer house in 1863. This present church was constructed in 1865 by freed slaves and given to other free slaves. Lewis Reeves Sams was a prominent planter who once owned half of Data Island. He constructed this beautiful house, notable for its exterior woodwork and iconic columns over Doric columns on the verandas, in 1852. The Sams family was able to reacquire the house after the Civil War and eventually became the property of George Waterhouse, a Maine transplant who operated a bustling store on Bay Street. According to local tradition, the house survived the Great Fire of 1907 by the efforts of Waterhouse cotton gin workers, who formed a bucket brigade and used wet bank blankets to beat out the flames. This is the third house of contrasting material that stood on this site. An old tabby structure was replaced with the clapboard dwelling that perished in the 1907 fire. William Joseph Thomas then built the current house of concrete stone blocks that were made near the property from special materials brought by boat from Charleston. We end our tour today by walking down the historic downtown area of Beaufort. Here we see several buildings that date back to the late 1800s and early 1900s. Again, don't forget that many of these buildings that we see in this street existed long before that, but many of the buildings were lost in a fire in the late 1800s and early 1900s. I hope you've enjoyed this Wandering Walks of Wonder walking tour here in beautiful Beaufort, South Carolina. Make sure to hit that like and subscribe button, and we will see you on our next Wandering Walks of Wonder walking tour. Take care now. Bye-bye.